everyone. We are from Perceptive Analytics. My name is Chaitanya.
Hi, I'm Sinha.
Hello, I'm Jagdish.
And we are here to talk about predicting churn. And all right, so we'll have a quick round of introduction about ourselves, and then we will dive right in. So my name is Chaitanya. I'm the CEO and founder of Perceptive Analytics. I get to work with a wonderful team and also serve clients. And we get to do good quality work, so I enjoy what I do. And in the time that I have free, then I basically do some yoga and keep myself sane.
I'm Sinha. I work as a team lead at Perceptive. I'm very passionate about analytics and finance. I like to trek, go on bike rides, and you know, play badminton. That's
my name is Jagdish. I'm from work as a data analyst at Perceptive Analytics. Graduate from IIT Bombay, where I discovered my love towards data science and analytics. Put me over here before you today.
Great. So let's dive right in. All right. So what is churn? So churn is essentially loss of customers. So every business, you know, or a customer is basically telling the business, see, hey, we don't want to deal with you. We probably will cancel, or we will go to a competition, and we'll get our stuff done. That's what churn is about. So what's the big deal about churn? Because every business will have certain customers coming in and certain customers going out all the time, right? So why should we even worry about churn? Why should we study it? Why should we predict it? But let's take an example. Let's say this is the dream house that you would like to build and you would like to live in. Okay, and you know, every month with the hard-earned salary, you're building it brick by brick. You know, every month you get your paycheck, and then you're able to lay over one more layer of bricks on this house, and so you're making progress. But suddenly you realize on a day that some of the bricks are missing. Okay, and so for you to make progress, now you have to refill those bricks. And once that is done, you'll be able to make further progress on it. So in a way, company is also like that. That, you know, what's a company? Nothing but, you know, of course, the team and everything, but also you are serving customers. See, the more the number of customers, the bigger the organization is, right? So basically, if you look at industries like telecom, or media, or SaaS companies, the larger the number of customers, the better it is, the, you know, it's growing. So in an analysis that we have done, this is what we have found. If you look at that chart, and if you have two situations, both starting at 100, and on the y-axis you have customers, and on the x-axis you have time over 3 years, a difference of 2% of churn on a scale of typically about 3 to 5% churn that companies usually experience, in a matter of 3 years, it makes a 2x difference. So you'll be able to grow double if your churn is lesser by 2 percentage points. Okay, isn't that good? In addition to that, there is a study that said a 2% improvement in churn can also lead to 10% cost savings. And on top of that, I think this is a very common knowledge that cost of acquisition is actually about 6 to 7% higher than, you know, serving existing customers. So not only churn puts you back, stunts your dreams, postpones your growth, right? It's also bad financially. So there are all these reasons why we want to predict churn. So let's fast forward to you know, an analysis that may have gotten done, churn analysis, and see what's the kind of thing that it can give us, okay? So this is an example of a churn prediction that was done. The data source, you can see the link right there. The data source was IBM Watson Telecom churn data, and someone did this and put this, you know, on the internet. So, so what they've done is something like this. So on the y-axis, you have, actually it's not the y-axis, but on the left, you have all the features, and the features are displayed in the descending order of feature importance. Okay? And on the top, you can see all the black lines are the ones that are contributing to churn, and all the red ones are the ones that are inhibiting churn or promoting retention. Okay? Let's look at some of these and try and understand what these are. So you can see this. Number one, you have a contract 2 year, which seems to be the most important feature in this analysis. And basically what this is saying is, and this is obviously US data, and they have those contracts for a time period, they give out handsets and so on and so forth. But what this is telling us is that somebody who has finished their 2 year term, they come out and they move on to a different company. Okay? So similarly, you can see a contract 1 year period is also an important parameter. But on the other hand, you can see those who are paying monthly, okay? Those who are paying monthly, they, you know, that feature contributes to retention of the customer, okay? So all of it, this is sort of one side of it. Let's look at some of the other features that are here. You can also see total charges. That's the second most important feature. I think that's sort of obvious in the sense that, you know, all of us, whenever we have received a large bill, we'll say, okay, you know, and you call the customer care, and probably you may not get a good response from them, and then you'll say, okay, you know, I don't want to stay this company. I will just move on to a different company where probably I'll get a better service. That's also, you know, it explains. So let's go to the next one. So here we have a few features. I hope you are able to read them. The font size is pretty small, but. So these are the kind of features we have. We have streaming movies, no. The person has internet service. Streaming TV, tech support, you know, device protection, and so on and so forth. These are probably all the quote-unquote value-added services that the telecom company would provide. And if you know, you don't have any of those, and in fact, at the bottom, you also have internet service, no, which means the customer has not even enabled internet service. No wonder they will churn, right? So at the bottom you can see, and all of these, by the way, all of the top features that I just mentioned, they all contribute to churn. And it also shows a different angle, which is that if you have customers that do not have multiple connections with the organization, they don't engage multiple services with the organization, then they are going to leave, right? So at the bottom you can actually see phone service, yes, multiple lines, yes, streaming TV, yes, streaming movies, yes, and so on and so forth. All of these sort of inhibit churn, so because they are contributing to retention. You can see they have red lines over there. So yep, this also sort of makes sense. Let's look at the other ones. So at the bottom, you have senior citizen, yes, okay? So if you're a senior citizen, if there is one thing that, you know, is very clear about senior citizens is that they don't want to change. Okay, they don't want to stay put. They want to maybe continue their service. So if senior citizen is a yes, then that is also contributing to retention. Okay, so let's just sort of, you know, step back and summarize what is this analysis sort of telling us. The one is it gives you the causes. Okay, the contract period is over, and so on and so forth, or it'll give you segments. Right, like the senior citizen, you know, those who have multiple engagements with the organization, and so on and so forth. And to some extent, it also tells you the timing, because depending on the industry, you could potentially have, you know, you could probably tone down your transactions in a bank, for example, and then, you know, you could churn a little later. But the fact that, you know, someone has toned down their transaction tells you that, hey, you know, the person is going to not want to deal with the company anymore. Okay? All right. So all of this is the output that you get out of churn analytics. And so if you are predicting churn, I think churn analytics will give you not just the customers who are going to churn, but it will give you more than that. I think that's a good thing. At 4:30 in the evening on a Friday, guys, is that a good thing? Yeah. All right. So typically, this is how a process would work. So essentially, you would take a churned customer history, you would use that to recognize patterns, build good features, and you build a predictive model, and you use the existing customer data and use the predictive model to arrive at a customer's at risk of churn. And then you're going to use that list to proactively engage them. And yeah, this is how it works. And what do we do here with the happy customers? We just ignore them. All right, so what we have done here, what we'll do from here on, is that we have taken an open data set, and we have done the churn analysis, and my colleague Sina and Jagdish are going to walk you through the model.
Yeah, so this was about KKBOX. So they were started in 2005, one of the first music streaming companies to be started. They went on to become one of the largest in the Asia. They cater to Mandarin-speaking audiences, okay? The data is about 1 million customers for about 12 years. And yeah, so here, the data we had can be put into three distinct buckets. First one is membership. So whenever somebody onboards, you get all their demographics, you know, when they onboarded, stuff like that. The transactional data. So whenever a subscription is made or an existing subscription is canceled, that's a transaction. So that gets recorded there. You know, what is the subscription length? How much was the price? What was the discount? Was that subscription auto-renewable? Things like that. Then the last bucket is user log data. So for every user on the platform, for every day, logs are being recorded. How many songs he or she listened to? What was the time spent on the platform? How many unique songs she listened to? How much percentage of how many songs she listened to? Things like that. So the objective was to predict who will churn in the next month. And to define churn here, so this is a platform on which both free and paid members can listen to songs, okay? And the definition of churn thus becomes important. The churn means if a person's subscription expires and he or she has not taken a new subscription within the next month, then he or she is considered churned. Remember, they can continue to listen to the songs and, you know, as a free user. So, yeah. So that is churn. So basically, an example is for the training data, if the membership, all those members whose membership expires on December is taken for training, then if they don't buy a new subscription on Jan, then they're churned, you know, just to be clear. Right, so, you know, just as some visuals for understanding which variables can explain churn. The width of the bar explains the volume of transactions or users who have used that channel, registration channel. The bars on the top say how many churn, the bars on the bottom say how many are active still. So even though channel 4, you know, is being used very less, it is one of the channels with a high number of churn. So, you know, that can explain churn. Higher subscription plan prices, you know, lower discounts, because discounts are very customized to the users. So again, higher subscription plan prices, higher churn. Auto renewal, if it was turned on during subscription, you know, less chance of churning. So these three, the first three you saw are actually transactional attributes from the second bucket. The last one is actually time spent on the platform. You see, high or low activity, it is not able to differentiate churn much because, like we said, they continue to use the platform as a free member. Right. So, yeah. So I would give to Jagdish to explain the feature engineering and model process.
Right. Feature engineering. Where do we start? So hope you all know about what a feature is, but I'll just give a 10-second intro for that. Feature is nothing but a container that contains a specific information of all the users. Example would be number of songs each user has heard in his entire lifespan, and so on. The similar features or specific informations can be stored as features. And feature engineering is all about generating such useful features so that the model can pick up the data patterns that are useful to solve the problem that you're interested in this case, the churn prediction. So all the features that can help the model learn who are the customers that are about to churn are good features, essentially. So why feature engineering is so important? Take any data science project, any machine learning model, I would consider feature engineering as the deciding stage of it. So not the model building, not the hyperparameter tuning, but this is the first base stage which decides the essential outcome of your performance of the model. Essentially, the most as a data scientist, one has to put in a lot of work and thought process to connect the business to mind, the problem he's trying to solve, and the data to generate features. And this is why to do that, because the more better features that you generate, it is easier and quick. The more better the model can pick up from the data to learn the patterns or the problem that you're trying to solve, in this case, churn prediction. And so the methodology that we follow for feature engineering in this particular case is inspired from the insights that Sina has just explained from the EDA. We just saw that the transactional and the user log data sets have contrasting abilities to predict churn. So we didn't want to mix them up and confuse the model. So we went on building separate models and separate feature sets for them. The other thing that we observed from the data was dynamic customer behavior with time. So it's actually like a person can use the platform for a month and may not use for the next coming month. So we have to keep track. Basically, the user customer behavior is not consistent with time. So we have to keep track of that. So in order to keep track of that, we introduced the time dimension using temporal features. Temporal features will introduce the time dimension. So it essentially helps the model to look at a particular user, not in an overall summary level, but to look at the throughout the customer journey, like how the customer behavior is changing with time. Another advantage of using temporal feature is that it amplifies the distinction between churn and not churn customers. If there are any data patterns, it amplifies those patterns. So keeping those things in mind, we have generated a total of 8 feature sets. One from membership, 3 from user log, and 4 from transactional data. A total combined total of 260 features. And we can see from the user log bucket features like number of songs heard, hours spent, and number of unique songs heard. Likewise, and the auto renew ratio, average plan price, and average discounts each user has received in transactional data. The user log and transactional data were actually dynamic. It changes with time. So we split those data into temporal features. Let's say, for example, average plan price. What is the average plan price each user has in the last week from now on? So that cutoff date is the reference date from during when you want to like calculate the churn prediction. Likewise for all the features in different time windows. Coming to the model architecture, so since we have 8 different feature sets and different churn patterns are lying in each of these feature sets, and we want to bring them all together, so our approach was, in one go, was an ensemble approach to bring them all and club them together. And this is our overall model approach. Let me walk you through that. On the leftmost part, the two columns on the leftmost part are the 10 base models we have built on the 8 feature sets that we have developed. All of those 10 base models go as an input to the first ensemble layer, where we built 2 ensemble models of stacking ensemble models using the meta algorithm of light GBM. And those 2 models, again, go up to the second ensemble model, which is the final model that gives us the predictions. This would be the entire workflow of the project. The trained data, once the model is trained with the trained data, the test data will be gone to the trained model to give us the predictions. This is a quick summary of all the models and their performances. I would like Sina to explain a little bit about the metrics.
Thank you, Jagdish. So yeah, since this churn is a specific type in which class imbalance is very high, accuracy may not be the right one to judge the model. So F1 score, I'm sure it's you guys all know, but still, harmonic mean. So the smallest. So if either precision or recall is lower, then F1 goes lower. So if you can look, take a look at model 5, where which comes from user log 2, the accuracy is really high, but F1 is low. So that's.
Okay.
Is the distinction between accuracy and F1 score clear? And we have used F1 score as the basis for validating the model. So we would, if the accuracy is not clear, what we'll do is, let's take a small example. Sina, why don't you
Okay, so accuracy only takes into account the true positives and true negatives. So if, let's say 100 people are there, 98 have not churned, only two churned, so then even if your model is not intelligent at all, if it says all 100 have not churned, then it's 98% accurate, but it's a stupid model. So that's accuracy.
It's algorithm in itself, right? Like GBM. It's a random forest. So we can see that the 3-4 highlighted rows tells us basically, leaving the last row, tells us the highest performing models in each of the data sets. Like the first row, which is membership, and the second highlighted row was from user log, best performing model from the user log data, and the ninth model, which is the best performing model from the transactional. We can see the huge variance in the F1 scores, and basically that tells us the capability of those data sets that have to predict churn. And the final ensemble model, like having the edge over all the base models that we have built on. Coming to the final feature importances, let me walk you through this. So here where the real meat lies. So if we see the first 5 to 6 rows, it's all about ease cancel ratio. Let me take a minute to explain that. Ease cancel ratio for every transaction, every subscription that I, as a user, I make on the platform, I have an option to cancel it later, after some time. So in that particular time period, of all the transactions that I made, how many transactions I've canceled, the ratio of that is called ease cancel ratio. That has dominant effect on predicting churn, in this case especially. That is more likely because the reason could be the users may be failing to find the appropriate plan that is suitable for them. So in that case, they end up exploring many subscription plans and finding out that it's not suitable for them, they end up canceling it. At some point in time, they would just go away. So, and the other dominant feature that we have was the auto-renew ratio. The ease cancel ratio is having a negative impact on churn. It's causing people to churn. So if we can reduce that factor, maybe if we can give a proper guiding principle for the users when they subscribe to a plan, like to navigate to the appropriate plan for them, then I think it would reduce the number of canceled transactions for each user, thereby reducing churn. And the other factor was auto-renew ratio, which is second most to ease cancel ratio, which is also the same. What is the number of transactions? What is the ratio of the transaction that I've, as a user, I've selected auto-renew ratio on? And this is in contrary to ease cancel ratio. It is actually telling us, higher the auto-renew ratio, it is telling us less likely the customer is about to churn. So if we can provide users some additional benefits to make them opt for the auto-renew ratio, that would probably cause for less churn. Then immediately after auto-renew ratio, we have subscription plan price, which is also having a negative impact on churn. So higher the price, obviously, higher the churn. So that's it from here.
Okay. So, you know, all the links for the data, some of the papers that we have put together, and also the papers that we have referenced, all of them we have given in that specific link. So if you'd like to check it out, please, you can take that. And it's simply bit.ly/churn-ref, right? And I think this is all we have. So are open for questions. Yes, please.
Just curious, so was this more like a proof of concept or was this model also deployed? I just to set the context, so I know, you know, model building and getting prediction accuracy is a good part, but when we try to deploy the model, that's where the actual challenges come through, especially if there is no feedback loop coming back into the model. And because we all also know the concept of model drift, wherein there are new features that might come in that might also impact the model itself. So just curious if this was deployed and if you had also you know, got into a scenario where you had to take care of the model drift as well.
Great question. So this one, we specifically took open source data and we worked on that. And then in order for the presentation, this is what we have done for this particular thing. Yeah.
Hello. Yeah, here, right in front
yes,
of you.
Please go
so
ahead.
You addressed class imbalance problems. Did you actually solve that, or is that something you are targeting?
So we have solved that is an open question, but we'll tell you how we have dealt with it, okay?
So, yeah, good question. Class imbalance can be solved using different techniques. Like the previous presentation, it was mentioning SMOT imbalance, SMOT techniques, and Addison techniques. So we could have gone for that, but the inherent ensemble approach can handle that thing. So when we are doing there is a well-studied papers how ensemble approach can handle and overcome class imbalance approach. That's why we didn't take additional techniques. We didn't go for additional techniques like SMOT or Addison. It finally got covered using ensemble approach itself. That is one of the main reason that why we chose ensemble approach over others individual models.
Thank you.
Nice presentation. Thank you. You did label the training data set based on the contract date. When the contract is expired for more than 1 month, you labeled it as a churn. And you included the same thing in your model as well. And it can be seen in the feature importance that first five features are actually the one where you see that it has been expired for quite some time. Do you think that removing this particular feature would improve the model? Because in practical scenario, you would like to retain a customer who has not been lost rather than someone who has already gone.
That's a really great question. So shows that at least one guy, he has his eyes open. Great question. Okay. I think, I'll tell you, this is specific to this particular case and data, okay? And even though you have those is cancel, and there are actually about the first five or six feature importances were all related to is cancel, okay? But the thing is, the data is related to current subscribers. It is not that they have canceled their current subscription, but they had a cancellation in the past that time period. So that's what it's telling you. So the essence of that is, if somebody has had a cancellation in those time periods, then it is likely that they will churn, as in even though they currently have a subscription, okay, they are likely to churn. They'll probably not have an active subscription 30 days from now. That's what it's telling you.
Okay.
They right now have an active subscription, but once it ends, they are more likely to churn because they have more canceled subscriptions prior to the one that they are using currently. It's a history, yeah.
Thank you.
Hello. My question is also on simple. Is there any thought process behind it? If it was already fixated, if you had to identify who are the customers or users who are more likely to churn in next 1 month or 2 months or 3 months or whatever be the time period, how would you approach that problem?
So basically, the idea was to stop, to get more customers on the premium services segment of the platform than compared to the free segment. I'm sure free will also help expand the platform, but premium is where we are interested in. And for this type of a music streaming stuff, we have lots of competition. So 1 month is actually a pretty much time, to be considered for churn. In fact, I would say, with the apps available, I would still take a lesser time for churning, probably some 3 weeks or 2 weeks, because I don't even have an app for three weeks on my phone. If I don't use it, I'll automatically delete that, right? So,
have to further break down that 1 month period for let's say one in first week or in 2 weeks or 3 weeks or 4 weeks, let's say from 1 week to 4 weeks, how would you approach that problem?
Yeah.
Would you build separate models for each of those dependent variables, or how would you have gone about it?
If we had to reduce the time, the definition for the churn to a lesser time, the subscription plan lens would be one consideration to be, you know, taken, because there are many plans in which, you know, which are not exactly 1 month, which are even lesser than a month, you know, so that kind of a data consideration also comes into issue. But the pretty much the same features, etc., would help in that case as well, because it is all you know, categorized to see how many transactions have had, you know, issues in the past, and how has the usage changed over time, and that is going to be the same for these new cases also. Okay. According to my understanding.
We are out of time. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.